All righty. So we have a couple of announcements this morning that I think you guys will be interested in. If you look in your bulletin, there is a page here called Upcoming Announcements and Events or News. It's a great thing to kind of pull in the refrigerator each week. I encourage you guys to do that because the week gets busy. Everybody gets busy. It's easy to forget some of these things, but there's several things coming up here. You'll see, obviously, tomorrow is Labor Day, so hopefully you guys are off work and get some time to rest and be with family and friends and just kind of enjoy that holiday. But Tuesday, September 5th, so this coming up Tuesday, we have a ladies' community Bible study. So you're invited to attend. It's a weekly Bible study focusing on the 80 main events in the Bible. So 80 main events in the Bible. Obviously, that's going to go for quite some time. This group is going to meet every Tuesday at 9 o'clock in the morning in the Sunday school room here that we have at Legardo, led by Beverly Mayo. So if you guys are interested in that, contact Ms. Beverly. That's a great opportunity. Again, it's open to the community. So if you have other ladies on Tuesday at 9 o'clock that aren't doing anything, invite them to come along. You know, great fellowship. It's a great time, and obviously there'll be a great focus on God's Word as well and how it applies to the women's lives today. Also, September the 10th, which is next Sunday, we're going to have a wedding shower honoring Ben and Zoe. It's going to be at 2 to 4 p.m. here at the church. They are registered at Amazon. If you would like to get their official registry, talk to Ben this morning. I'm sure he can give that to you. But that's 2 to 4 p.m. next Sunday here at the church, wedding shower for Ben and Zoe. Also, next Sunday we have choir rehearsal at 4:30. Are they off this Sunday? Okay, off this Sunday. And then September 22nd through 24, we have the Favored Women's Fall Retreat. It's a 3-day, 2-night event. I think all the money has been turned in at this point. If you have questions on that, I know Pam is kind of busy right now with family needs, but if you want to get with her next week sometime about details, I'm sure she'd be happy to provide that. And then October 1st is a Sunday. We're going to have a wedding shower for Alicia and Truman, and that's also 2 to 4 p.m. You'll see their wedding website is below, so if you want to buy them a gift from there, you can. But again, that's 2 to 4 p.m., same time as Ben and Zoe's, but October the 1st, okay? So several showers coming up. I know we had one recently as well. We had a baby shower recently. So that's pretty exciting. A lot of fun things at the church, a lot of things to celebrate and give God glory for this morning. As we go into our time of worship today, I want to leave you guys with just a quick verse here in Matthew. And you'll see while we're going over this here. And I may just have to pull it from, okay. So I'll just say it, but I'll read it off to you. It's in Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 through 20. It says, "And the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And then Jesus came to them and said, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age.'" And that's just a wonderful verse of the Great Commission. We go over it a lot in church. But it's a great reminder. As we go into the message this morning, we're going to have a focus this morning on discipleship. The importance of it, how it can be ran in a church, just biblically. Because this is an important concept of the Christian life that a lot of times gets overlooked. And because of that, the church suffers. And so I think this morning you all be encouraged and blessed and challenged by that. But I want you guys to think about the concept of discipleship and making disciples this morning. What does it really mean to be a disciple of Jesus Christ? Not just somebody that comes in on a Sunday morning, not just somebody that goes to a Bible study every now and then, but to truly be a disciple of Jesus Christ every day of the week. What does it mean to be that way this morning, and how do you make others of that? Keep that concept in mind. Let me pray for us, and we'll bring Rodney up. Dear Lord, thank you so much just for showing us, God, that as you left this earth, you challenged and encouraged us to make disciples. And you're not calling us to do that alone. You give us the Holy Spirit to help and to guide us and to strengthen us to do that. So God, I ask this morning that you put your Spirit upon this place. That your Spirit just rest here with us, God. And that as we worship and pour out our hearts to you, that we just see your will truly for our lives. Speak to each of us individually this morning. Let us not just be hearers, but also doers of the word. And take what you teach us and apply it to our lives today. Be better disciples of you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Hope and pray you all have had a wonderful week in the Lord, that you've sensed His presence, that He's helped you step along. We've got the blue team. Chris, you wearing blue. We got the blue team. Everybody got the message. Amen. We're going to go to the Lord as a worship team, and then we're going to invite you as a congregation to stand to our feet. Let's give God some glory. Let's give Him some hallelujahs, and let's worship Him today. We have come into His house. Let's sing together. All right, family, here we go. We have come into His house and gathered in His name to worship Him. Is that why you came? A neighbor to God's house this morning. People said, amen. Amen. You all may be seated.
All right, young lady. Well, good morning. Thank y'all for being friendly and greeting one another this morning. For special music, I'm going to sing a song that's done by Chris Rice a few years ago. It's called Come to Jesus.
Come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away. Precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, just sing to Jesus. Sing to Jesus and live. Like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. And remember when you walk, sometimes we fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, fall. Jesus and live. Sometimes the way is lonely, still can fill with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus. Go on and cry to Jesus. Cry to Jesus and live. Oh, and when the love spills over and music fills the night, when you can't contain your joy inside, then dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus and live. Oh. And with your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye. Then go in peace and laugh on glory's side. Fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live. Fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus and live.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Chris, for that song, Fly to Jesus. Let's all stand to our feet and let's sing one of our anthems of our faith. All hail the power of Jesus' name. And let's sing aloud as we worship and think about that precious name.
All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall.
Folks, we'll stand before him one day and we'll sing that chorus so majestic, so resounding. Lord of all the things that try to be master in our life, there's nothing that compares to that wonderful name and person of Christ Jesus. And it's our prayer and worship that he's your master, that he's your Lord, and that name, no other but wonderful. Our next song, his name is wonderful. Let's sing together.
His name is wonderful. Oh, his name is wonderful. His name.
Hallelujah. Is he your Lord today? Let's sing this song together, Your Name. What's in a name? Especially when it concerns Jesus. Morning dawns and evening fades. You inspire songs of praise that rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. Oh, only his name, folks. God, Alpha and Omega, King of the Jews, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, the Bread of Life, the Word, the Living Stone, the Redeemer, Christ, the Son of God. For there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Lord, as a people calling, we come as a people anticipating. We come, Lord, as a church united, Lord, for the express cause of your name. Your name, Lord, that has blessed us. Your name, Lord, that has caused us to have salvation through faith, Lord, by the mercy of heaven itself. Your name, Lord, when we call and when we beckon, Lord, intercedes for us, even in our sin. Your name, Lord, that was crucified and resurrected. Lord, that person of Christ Jesus, we can't help but cry out your name. Lord, speak to us today. Speak to us, Lord, and allow your word, your holy scriptures to teach and inspire and persuade us today, Lord, as you anoint Brother Bradley. Bring it to us, God. Bring it to us, Lord. And we'll be sure to praise that name today. In Jesus we pray. Amen and amen.
All right, good morning. Hey, it's a pleasure and honor to be with you guys this morning. This past weekend was a pretty exciting weekend because football is now back. So I know many of you here are probably watched some games yesterday. I know there's another one today. It's always a fun, exciting season to see everybody wear their colors to church and to out to eat. And I was wearing Alabama gear yesterday. I know it's not popular here, but we did well too. So I told Grace yesterday, I think everybody should be in a good mood though, because Kentucky, Tennessee, and Alabama all won yesterday. So I think we're pretty much covered. So we should be in good spirits this morning. But football season is always a fun time of the year. Everybody gets really excited and passionate. And I've been a lifelong fan of Alabama's football team. But there's only thank you, roll tide. But there's definitely certain things that I wouldn't do to support them. So I'll wear their jersey, you know, I'll go to games, and I'll talk about them and watch them. But, you know, if Nick Saban came out tomorrow and said that if you're going to support Alabama, you have to, you know, wear the LGBTQ pride logo from now on out, then there's a limit there. You know, I wouldn't go that far. And it's because I'm a fan of Alabama's football team, but I'm not a disciple of their team. You know, I'm a supporter, but I'm not a disciple. And there's a difference there. And the same is true in our church lives today. As we're going to talk about this morning, it's easy to be a fan and a supporter, especially when a team is good, especially when a church is going well and there's excitement going on. But being a disciple is a whole different story. It takes a lot deeper commitment to that and a lot deeper walk with Christ. And so we're going to talk about that a little bit this morning. And I want to read off the passage again in Matthew, because that's our main focus today. And I actually kind of retitled this message, A Call to Discipleship. Because discipleship is important in the church, but it's actually a calling for all Christians. It's not just a great suggestion or something that would be good to do. Discipleship is a call that all of us have in our lives as believers, whether we're in church or not. And so I want to challenge us here today in Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 through 20. And I'll read it off one more time. It says, "Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.'" And now, catch this part here in verse 20. This is what we're going to be kind of talking about more this morning. "And teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." So before we dive into the call that Jesus puts in our life to make disciples, we have to understand first, what is a disciple? And that word is thrown around a lot in church, but sometimes we don't have a great definition of what that looks like. The number one thing I want us to talk about this morning is, you can't make disciples if you're not a disciple yourself. You can't make disciples if you're not a true disciple yourself. That would be like trying to encourage somebody to take on a position at work and trying to train them to be a leader when you're not a leader yourself. You know, you're gonna fail, you're gonna fall short. You can't train up disciples if you don't know what it is yourself and if you're not actively a disciple yourself. So what is a disciple? A disciple is committed to doing whatever the leader says to do. They have complete trust in that person. Even if the person tells them to do something that maybe seems unrealistic, they will go forth and do it with all they have within them. And this is the difference between being a supporter and a disciple. If you're a supporter of Jesus Christ, you may believe the stories in the Bible. You may believe that he is a Savior. And you come to church and maybe you worship him sometimes. But when he calls you to do something that is challenging or outside of your comfort zone or maybe even dangerous, you draw a line. You say, there's only so far I'd go to support that person or that cause. A disciple has no limitations. It says, whatever that person calls me to do, whatever they lead me in, I'm going to go forth and do it, and not do it half-heartedly, do it full-heartedly, because I completely trust my life to that person. That's why you're not a disciple of many people. Hopefully, you're really only a disciple of Jesus Christ. Because a disciple, it involves a much deeper commitment than just being a supporter or a fan or a follower. The difference between a churchgoer and a follower of Jesus is like this. A churchgoer follower of Jesus may like a lot of things going on in the church. They may enjoy things about Jesus. They may even worship him from time to time. They may go to a ministry project. However, when life gets hard and something unexpected happens, they may also be very easily able to flee from the faith because they don't have a deep-rooted commitment in Christ. Furthermore, when the Holy Spirit prompts them to do something outside of their comfort zone, they'll become uncommitted very quickly and use every excuse in the book on why they can't do what God's calling them to do. And you see this a lot in churches today. You know, God has a mission project on your heart, or maybe God has a ministry on your heart, and you go to maybe a pastor or a church leader, and you say, hey, Brother Bradley, you know, I feel like God, I've been talking to God lately, and he laid on my heart, just keeps pressing me to start a women's ministry, maybe something like that. And if I were to encourage you and say, well, that's great, why don't you take a lead in that and start that ministry? Why would you say, well, that's not what I mean. I think maybe somebody else should do that. Sometimes God is prompting you and prompting your heart to do something for him, and maybe you're not comfortable doing that, but he'll give you the comfort and the strength and the peace and the people over time to build that ministry up. You know, there's a great saying that God doesn't call the equipped, he equips the called. So if God is calling you to do something, understand that God's going to equip you along the way. And the church will help and support, but God may also be calling you to lead that ministry, not be the ministry that God's put on your heart. A disciple of Jesus Christ is all in all parts of life. Whether it seems rational or not, whatever Jesus calls them to do, they run and do it without making excuses. Now, I want you guys to think about this. A disciple of Jesus does not only worship on Sunday mornings, but worship is a part of their everyday routine. I want you to think about that this morning. Worship is a part of their everyday routine. They don't put on their calendar, Sunday morning is my time to worship God, and the rest of the week is time to do my own thing. Worship is a part of their everyday routine. Now, worship doesn't always mean just singing songs. Oh, that's a wonderful way to worship. It also means, you know, doing things, reading his word, studying, setting time each day for him, having an active prayer life. You know, how many of you, when you leave Sunday morning, you don't open your Bibles again until the next Sunday morning? How many of you leave Sunday morning and really don't pray throughout the week until you come to prayer time on Sunday morning? Worship is a part of your everyday routine if you're a disciple, because again, he's the most important person in your life, and you're fully bought out into his mission and his plan. They have a clear understanding of their mission and call here on earth. They're also willing to give up whatever it takes to achieve that mission and that call. So you look at the passage here in Matthew 28. It says the 11 disciples. Now, some people will say, well, there was 12, but at this point, Judas had already betrayed Jesus. And so you have the 11 disciples here as Jesus is about to go up into heaven, descend back into heaven. And he tells them, these are the most committed followers of him. And these are people that have lived with him 3 years in a row, you know, pretty much every day, doing things for his glory. And he tells them to make disciples of all nations and teach them to obey everything I have commanded you. And if you do that, I promise I'm going to be with you always to the very end of the age. And if you look through the rest of the New Testament, especially the writings of Paul, you'll see that they did some crazy things to spread the gospel back then. The society they lived in was very, very anti-Christian. You know, the Roman government was in power. They did not support Christianity. They did not support the cause of Jesus Christ. And so a lot of times if they did, somebody supported that, their life was actually in danger. Very easily they could have died. Most of the disciples ended up giving their lives for this mission, if you go back and read through the New Testament. But there's also other things they gave up to follow Jesus. I want you guys to listen to this here, Mark 1:20. And immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with them, and their hired servants, and followed him. So you look at Mark, God says, I want you to be my disciple. Mark and John, they immediately come and flee and follow him. They leave their occupation. They leave their father. I mean, think about that. Think about how hard that would be, especially in that time period. A lot of these people were fishermen. And so they're not making a huge salary anyways. And Jesus is calling them to leave all that behind. Trust me, I'll provide for you. And they leave all of that and run after him. That's a major sacrifice that they made back then. If you look in Luke 9, 57 through 62, it says, as they were going along the road, someone said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. So Jesus then turns around and speaks to that person. He says, foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. To another he said, follow me. But he said, Lord, let me first go and bury my father. And Jesus said to him, leave the dead to bury their own dead. But as far as for you, you come and go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Yet another said, I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those in my home. When Jesus called the disciples in the Bible, they immediately left and followed him. They left all their previous things they were tied to behind and ran after him. They gave up safety, they gave up their jobs, and like I said, many of them gave up their lives in the end. And now Jesus is not calling all of us to go and leave everything behind, necessarily, but he's saying that if you want to be my disciple, you have to value me so much more than everything else, that if my mission and my calling takes you away from something like that, you're willing to leave it behind to do what I'm calling you to do. And there's many of us today that, especially in America, as blessed as we are possession-wise, we have all kinds of possessions, and we have all kinds of activities, and TV, and all this kind of thing. You know, if God prompts you and puts in your heart to get rid of the boat, or get rid of the TV, or get rid of this, or get rid of that because it's causing a distraction in your life, many of us would say, no, there's no, I can't get rid of that. I'm sorry, God. Like, you know, that's my time throughout the week. You know, you have your time on Sunday. Think about in your life today, is there anything that you couldn't give up to follow Christ? And if so, that thing or that person has become an idol in your life. And until you get rid of that idol and lay it at God's feet and say, God, I'm willing to get rid of it, if it means following you, and if you call me to get rid of that, is when you start truly becoming a disciple for Jesus and he starts to use you in a powerful way. Because if you're holding on to things in your life, especially material things, eventually this world's going to fade away and all those things are going to fade away too. And the only thing that's going to last is what you did for Christ and his kingdom. So if you have things you're holding on to today that you value more than God, you're never going to be a full disciple until you let those things go at his feet. A disciple can be defined as someone that denies themselves, takes up their cross every day, and follows Jesus. And so I want you guys to think about which one are you this morning. And if you are a disciple, your next call, like Jesus called these disciples, is to make other disciples. So I want us to look at that this morning, the importance of discipleship. Discipleship can be defined as the intentional process of guiding and equipping individuals to become committed followers of Christ. It involves teaching, mentoring, and nurturing believers to grow in their knowledge of God's Word and develop a deeper relationship with Him. And it also calls you to teach others to live out the teachings of Jesus in their daily lives. Think about what it says here in Matthew again. It says, in teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. If you're going to teach somebody to obey everything that God's commanded for them to do, it's not going to take one conversation, okay? There's no way you're going to be able to tell the whole Bible in one conversation. It's an ongoing process. It's a commitment you make to that person and their spiritual well-being. A lot of times this happens between an older person and a younger person. Somebody that's been through that stage of life, they understand the trials and the issues that come. They see somebody younger that's about to go through the same things. Maybe somebody's about to have a kid, or maybe somebody's about to get married, and you've been married for 10 years, and you've had kids, and they've grown up. You understand that struggle, that next trial that life's going to throw at them. And so you take it upon yourself to set time aside and pour into that person. You set time aside to teach them lessons you've learned, mistakes you've made, and things you've learned from those. You take time to teach them what God's Word says about that stage in their life and how to encourage and equip them. And again, this is not a one-time conversation. It's an ongoing process. And if the church can grab hold of this idea of the older pouring into the younger, and then those people pouring into their younger people, and the whole church is poured into others, as they're also getting poured into by their own discipleship and poured into God's word, the church gets filled with the Holy Spirit. And you have people passionate and on fire, and people that grow up in the church. By the time they're 20, 30, 40 years old, they're ready to be the next leaders of the church because they're prepared. And they have that knowledge and that confidence in God. Jesus commands all disciples to go forth and make more disciples. It's an active and ongoing process for each believer's life. It doesn't just stop when you make one disciple. I want you guys to think about this here. The most important mission you have on earth, regardless of your job title, is to make disciples of Jesus Christ. I want you to think about that. The most important job you have on earth, regardless of what you do on your typical workday job, is to make disciples for Jesus Christ. When you get to heaven, there's going to be managers, there's going to be CEOs there, there's going to be people that just work the basic entry-level jobs. And Jesus is not going to say, hey, congratulations, you moved all the way up in the company, you're the CEO, or you worked, you know, all this time, I'm so proud of you. He's going to look and say, did you make disciples for me? In the position that I put you in, did you pour out everything you had into living a life that honored and glorified me, and did you make other disciples? And if the answer is no, it doesn't matter what position you held on earthly position, that's not going to be good enough. Jesus says the most important call we have in our life is to, one, be a disciple for him, and then make other disciples for him. So this is where many of the churches start making excuses. 95% of Christians do not share their faith with anybody. 95% of Christians never share their faith with anybody. And then the church wants to complain about society today and why the society is not following God. Well, if 95% of you guys aren't sharing your faith, then no wonder the society is turning away from God, because society is sharing their beliefs every day. And if the church wants to step up and start sharing their beliefs, we would see a change in our country. We would see a change in society. The part that gets people is they don't know how to start this, how to go. Again, the concept here is to go. And if you want to make disciples, you have to first share the gospel with somebody. And so, how do you do that? I want you to think about this today. If you're trying to share the gospel with somebody, you don't have to have a certain script. You don't have to have a certain background, a certain theological belief. Just take what God's laid on your heart, what God's done for you, and trust. Again, full-heartedly, a disciple full-heartedly trust their leader, that the Holy Spirit is going to give you the words to say in the right moment. And the Holy Spirit is going to open the doors, and when he opens the doors, have confidence in him. Because again, none of us are going to save anybody. Our job is not to save anybody. Our job is to point them to the Savior. And so if we do that this morning, if we just point them to the Savior, it's their decision if they follow Christ or not. But that's our part. That's our mission. That's our focus, is to point them to him. Sharing the gospel starts with looking for divine appointments in your daily life. I want you to think of this concept. Somebody told me this recently, and I just keep thinking about it, and it keeps sticking in my mind, and it's a very interesting concept called divine appointments. And what that is that a lot of people will say, well, God, I don't have any opportunity to share the gospel. In my life, I just don't see any chance or any opportunity to share the gospel. But if you're not actively looking for those opportunities, you're probably missing them. And what I mean by that is that God puts divine appointments in everybody's life. In your current position and what you're doing now, whether you're retired or whether you're working, you know, 60 hours a week, there are people you're going to come in contact with at the grocery store, at work, even at church. And if you're open to the Holy Spirit using you to share the gospel, you're going to, and you pray that God open my eyes to who you want me to share with today, God will put divine appointments in your life to share with that person. He's going to put somebody in your pathway. You're going to cross somebody that needs help and encouragement. But if you're too busy and too focused on other things besides God, you'll miss what the opportunity that was in front of you. Think about this. You may go to the checkout counter at Kroger or Publix or wherever you buy groceries, and the checkout person, whether it's a girl or a boy, maybe they're really depressed. They just seem like they're in a horrible mood, you know, and our selfish human nature could look at that and say, man, I got the worst checkout person here. It's going to be a rough line here. you know, they're taking forever, and you get annoyed with them. You're checking your phone, other things going on, and your mind's racing to what you got to do after the grocery store, and you missed the divine appointment that God put in front of you. Because God may have put you there because he knew you could encourage that person. And you had a word of just encouragement that you could share with that person that could change their whole day around. But instead, we were so focused on everything else that we missed it, and then we tell God, I don't have any divine appointments in my life. That's not true. You have to open your eyes to them and to see them. There are people out there that are lost and are hurting. And I will tell you this. It's amazing how many people, if you look at them and just say, hey, how's your day going? And they tell you whatever answer. If you ask them, is there anything I can just pray for you about today? Just a short little prayer. Most people, even if they're not religious whatsoever, will allow you to pray for them. There's something about that. Most people will give you some kind of thing that's going on in their life. And that is an open door to sharing the gospel and to point them back to Christ. Praying today that God will put someone in your path to witness to, and that God will give you the wisdom and strength to witness to that person when the opportunity arises. So I want you to think about your life right now and the season you're in. You may like it, you may not like it, but God has you in the season of your life for a reason. There are people God put in your life right now for a reason. Think for a moment about the lost people that you encounter every single day. Are you taking advantage of the divine appointments God has given you? If you want to be used mightily by God, it starts with being obedient in the callings he has in your life right now. If you can't witness to those you're around every day, then how are you going to be able to witness to those you never met? If you've been placed in a unique, you've been in a place in a unique spot in this world that nobody else is in, there are people you're going to come across in your life that I will never encounter. There are people that you're going to come across in your life that your family's never going to encounter. God has put certain people in your life you probably see on a regular basis that no one else has that relationship with or that opportunity with. Are you taking advantage of it? Or are you just keeping your religion to yourself and letting them do their own life and then hoping for the best? Hoping for the best is not making disciples. And also I want you guys to think about this part here before we get to our last point. This is very important here. Listen to this one closely. Sharing the gospel also involves understanding the most important task each day. Looking for the most important task God has in your life each day. Here's what I mean by that. There was a CEO that wrote this concept several years ago. And he's a Christian. And he said that he would get so caught up in all the daily tasks, his emails, you know, he's got phone calls, texts. He said, I was just slammed every day. He said, I would come in early in the morning, and he said, I would just dread going through all the emails and everything. But he said, my mind was just going a million places all day long. And he said, there was one day that a girl, there was a secretary, asked if she could meet with him privately for, you know, 15 minutes. And he said, no, I'm too busy. I just, you know, I don't have time for that. If I do that, the rest of the day is thrown off. Because I got stuff scheduled every single part of the day. And then he said he just felt this prompting from God to go talk to that person. He said, he was upset about it. He was kind of bothered, but he said he couldn't shake that feeling. So he messaged the girl back and said, sure, let's go. Let me meet with you. Well, he meets with the secretary. Instead of her downloading more information about things he had to do, she let him know that her father had just passed away, and she was wondering if she could take off work that day. She was in tears and just in a really, really bad state. And he said immediately he realized that that was the most important task he could do that day, was to minister to that girl. So he said he had a chance to pray with her, to encourage her, just to support her. And he said, seeing the impact that made on that girl's life, he said, open my eyes to, I'm missing these things every single day because I'm so busy, my mind is somewhere else. He said, you know, projects and things like that I have going on at work, those will come and go. But the mark I make on people for Jesus, that's what's going to last forever. And I think if we can pray every day that, Holy Spirit, let me not be so busy today that I missed the most important task today. God will put a person on your mind, person on your heart, somebody that you can just minister to and pour into, maybe just for 10, 15 minutes, but it will make an eternity impact if you do that. And as we conclude here, I want you guys to think about this. The last part about discipleship, if you do share the gospel and people start coming to faith, is not just leaving them there. And a lot of churches that are good outreach churches, I feel like can miss the mark sometimes in this, because they share the gospel, they do a great job with that, and many new believers are coming in, But then once they come in, they're kind of just left on their own to learn and to grow. And again, discipleship is a commitment you have between somebody and God that you're going to pour into that person, invest in that person on a longer basis. So I want you guys to understand this. Understand that leading somebody to Christ does not mean your job as a Christian is over. This is witnessing, which is part of discipleship, but it's not discipleship in itself. It can start the process, but again, it's not discipleship in and of itself. Churches need a clear vision and mission for discipleship. They need a clearly outlined discipleship program, and they need to stick with it. They need to promote it and constantly talk about it, and they need to get everybody on board. And if everybody on board has the same mindset, the same vision, that discipleship's important, we're going to do that here, and it's biblical, then the whole church will benefit greatly because of it. And now this morning, I'm not here to give you some robust discipleship program. I'm not in the position to do that. But I want to encourage you something discipleship-wise that you can do whether you have a senior pastor or not, just as a Christian. One-on-ones are key to a great discipleship program. It's important that a slightly older believer pours into a slightly younger believer. You know, it's great if anybody wants to disciple anybody in the church, but to me, the way it works best is if you have a slightly older person pouring into a slightly younger, because again, they just went through that stage of life and they can pour into that. One-on-one mentorship is a powerful component of discipleship. There should be intentional mentorship relationships where those being discipled can receive personalized guidance, support, and accountability from an experienced believer. Highlight the significance of the relationships in fostering spiritual growth, providing a safe place for questions and doubts, and modeling Christ-like character. One of the things that I went through when I was in college was we had a few professors that saw some similarities in students to where maybe they were at when they were in college, and they would ask if we could just get coffee once a month, you know, or every few weeks. And instead of talking about everything school-wise, they would ask, how's your life going? You know, how's campus life for you? You know, how are your relationships going? And it wasn't a conversation where they could beat you down and say, oh, Bradley, how terrible a person you are. It was, you know, what's your struggles here, and can I give you any kind of guidance or advice? And that was instrumental in growing in that season of life. Because especially people that are in college, people that are young adults, they're experiencing things for the first time at a very fast pace. And sometimes it's hard to know what is the right thing to do. So having somebody that's experienced, that's been through that, they can just pour into them and say, hey, look, Bradley, I've been there. I've done that. Let me give you some advice that God's given me and what's worked for me. It helps that person so much. These one-on-one conversations can be a time where you just let that other person open up about struggles they're going through. You pray with them, you encourage them, and maybe you read some scripture off together. And the way discipleship works the best on one-on-ones is that that person not only meets with the person on maybe a monthly basis, but also each week maybe checks up on the person, sends them a phone call or a text message, and it says, how are you doing this week? Is there anything I can pray for you about? Any questions you may have? And if you can do a reading plan together, oh man, that's great. If you can read you're going to read Matthew 1 through 3 this week. And then at the end of the week, you guys talk about it for a little bit. Say, what did you learn? And what did you learn? And you can learn from each other. You can grow from one another. And you can say, well, did you catch this point as well? And then all of a sudden, wow, now you're growing in scripture together. You're praying together. You're encouraging one another. And then when life does get really hard for that person, whether it's hard right now or not, when it does get hard, they have somebody they can call right away and say, hey, so-and-so, I'm struggling. I need your help right now. And they have somebody in the church they can go to and they feel comfortable doing that with. It's a serious commitment, but it's important. And so what I want to challenge us with this morning, if you're somebody in the church that would like this kind of discipleship, this kind of mentorship from somebody that's older, I put a sheet out there as I was coming in to the sanctuary after Sunday school. There's a sheet out there you can sign your name, put your phone number and email, just to say, hey, I would like having that kind of mentorship in my life. And then if you see somebody on that list, you think, hey, I'm about, you know, maybe 10 years older than that person, I would love to pour into that person. And preferably women on women and men on men, because there can be some personal things that you can talk about. Then you can sign your name to the right side of that to say, hey, I'm agreeing to disciple this person. And again, it's not that you have to have some kind of robust program. It's just that you're committing to maybe meet with the person once a month, and just checking in on them weekly and encouraging them. And it can look different for every person and geared differently toward every person. But you'll see on the sign-up sheet in the back there, on the left-hand side, if you want to be mentored, whether you're older or younger, and just put your name, put your information, and then I want you guys to also be praying about those on the list and say, is God putting in my heart, maybe I should be discipling that person. Maybe I should be discipling that person. And if so, put your name on the list and then contact one another. And that can take place outside the church and look different for everybody. But I believe if we do this as a church, it's going to be instrumental in growing in our church. If young people like college-age kids and teenagers come to our church and they see that there's older people that want to pour into them and that are actively doing that, that will keep them here. And that will keep them growing and learning. In your discipleship times, as we close, I want to challenge you to meet with the person, like I said, once a month. Talk about spiritual things, but also talk about life in general. You're going to be that person's accountability partner. In your discipleship times, cultivate a supportive and nurturing environment. It's not a come-down session. It's a build-up session in Christ. Foster a sense of belonging and acceptance where the person you're discipling feels comfortable sharing their struggles, victories, and questions. I want you to think about creating opportunities for spiritual discussions, prayer, and fellowship to build authentic relationships and a strong community where you can thrive and learn from one another. Accountability is a crucial part in discipleship. There was a person, I'll share this as we close, when I was in college, and like I said, it is nice if you have somebody a little bit older, a little bit younger. This person was not a whole lot younger than me because we were both in college together, but I was in a position at that point, I was older in college, and I was in a leadership position on campus. And he came to me privately one day, and we were friends, but we weren't real close. And he came to me and he said, Bradley, can I talk to you for a minute? So I said, yeah, sure, you know, that's what I'm here for. And he opened up about something I just had no idea. The guy was a good guy, and I never thought he would have been involved in this, but he said, I'm really involved in pornography. He said, I can't control it. He said, it's gotten to a point where it's happening every day. He said, and I can't get out of it. And, you know, being a younger Christian and in college, I was like, oh gosh, that's a tough challenge to overcome that. But I was like, God put me in this position for a reason. And let me think through that and pray through that. So I started meeting with the guy once a week. And we started meeting once a week. And I would ask him how life's going. How are things going? I would give him things, tips and tricks and things that I thought would help overcome some of that, and it helped. And then throughout the week sometimes, I would check in on him and say, hey, how's today going? And if he had a really hard day, there was times he came to me and said, hey, today I'm struggling, and I feel like I'm about to go down that road. Can I talk to you for a minute? Can we go take a walk somewhere? Can we go do something? And I even bought an app that went on his phone called Covenant Eyes that blocked him from going to certain sites. And if you went to those sites, I got a notification on my phone so I could have a conversation with him and say, hey, brother, I saw you struggle today. You know, can we talk about it? And I ended up paying for that even after I left college for quite some time. And today, I believe the person's in a really good spot. He's in a really good spot spiritually. But it was important that he was willing to come to me and ask to be mentored. He saw that that was something that I wasn't struggling with. I struggled with many other things. That was something that at that point in my life, I'd overcome that and not struggle with that. So he knew I could pour into him and help him. And then I was willing to disciple him, and it ended up being a wonderful relationship. And I was blessed from it too. So there's 2 points of that. Be willing to be discipled by others. You're never too old to be discipled. You're never going to know it all. Be willing and be open to being discipled by somebody else. And if somebody else is asking for discipleship, even if you're already busy and you feel like your schedule is full, try to loosen things up where you have time to disciple that person. It will be one of the greatest blessings in your life to do so. And when you get to heaven one day, you'll be rewarded for that. And it makes a difference. So let me pray for us. Dora, thank you so much just for your message and your word in Matthew, showing us, God, that you're calling us to go forth and make disciples, but also have a discipleship mindset, that we don't just make disciples and then leave it there, but we pour into that person over time. So God, I ask that we be open this morning to being discipled by somebody else in the church, and that if we are open, somebody else in the church wants to disciple us and pour into us. Put that person in our hearts and minds this morning, and let us full-heartedly run after you as your disciple. In your name we pray. Amen.
Let's all stand to our feet for this time of invitation. If God spoke to you, what a wonderful message about being disciples, becoming a discipler. As we look to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, let's sing together. If God's calling you, the altars are open.
Oh, so are you.
God's house, amen. If you're visiting today, we say welcome. If you're part of the family, thanks for being here. Thank you for being faithful and being prayer for our church. There's a lot of many needs around, many folks who aren't here today. Think of Sister Pam, and they put her mother in hospice. Want to continue to lift her up and that family during that situation. Sister Carol, I don't think she's here today. She's been dealing with some struggles. She had to go to the hospital for some fluids this past week. So we have some situations around. Don't have time to share all the requests, but be a prayer warrior this week. Pray for our family. You would pray for your immediate ones, right? But pray for your church family. Lift us up. I need prayer. And I'm sure you do too. And there's no greater way to get that sense of unity behind the cross of Christ Jesus than to join hands in prayer spiritually. But I like joining hands physically as well, amen? So would you stand to your feet? We'll be dismissed in a song. Grab a neighbor's hand. Tell them you love them as we sing together, Amazing Grace. Sing together, family.
Oh, I will love the
church family. Have a wonderful day in our Lord.